Hello everyone. In this video, I'll be talking about sensorineural hearing loss. Now, sensorineural hearing loss can be either of sensory type, that is involvement of the cochlea, or neural type, that is involvement of the eighth nerve, or central type, that is involvement of the auditory pathway beyond the eighth nerve up till the auditory cortex. So neural and central, they both are sometimes called retrocochlear. So sensorineural loss, it is can be sensory, neural or central. The etiology of sensorineural hearing loss can be broadly divided into congenital and acquired causes. In congenital also, there can be three categories. There can be congenital anomalies of the inner ear, or there can be some prenatal factors or some perinatal factors which are responsible for the development of sensorineural hearing loss. So what are the congenital anomalies of the inner ear? These are the pathologies in the inner ear, developmental anomalies. For example, Shebe's dysplasia, it is cochleosacular dysplasia where there is failure of development of cochlea and the saccule. Then Alexander's dysplasia, in which the basal turn of cochlea fails to develop, and this leads to high frequency sensorineural loss. Then Bing-Siebenmann dysplasia, it is complete absence of the membranous labyrinth. Then Mitchell dysplasia, it is complete absence of bony as well as membranous labyrinth. And Mondini dysplasia, here only basal coil is present. So these are some of the congenital anomalies of the inner ear which lead to malformed inner ear and hence sensorineural hearing loss. Another category of congenital is there are some maternal factors which are responsible for hearing loss in the child. These are infections. For example, torches, that is toxoplasmosis, rubella, cytomegalovirus, herpes, and syphilis. Then autotoxic drugs, if the mother is taking these drugs during pregnancy, they have autotoxic effect on the child's inner ear. Similarly, if the mother is taking some radiations, especially during the first trimester, then it can have adverse effect on the inner ear. And similarly, some nutritional deficiencies, some diabetic and then hormonal deficiency like hypothyroidism, all these are responsible for sensorineural hearing loss in a child. Third part of congenital causes, it can be perinatal causes, that is anoxia. Now anoxia during birth, that is birth asphyxia, it can be because of placenta previa, it can be because of prolonged labor or cord prolapse. In any of these conditions, there is hampered blood supply to the inner ear and brain, which leads to sensorineural hearing loss. Similarly, in prematurity and lower birth weight babies, especially if the birth weight is below 1.5 kilograms, then they are more susceptible to have sensorineural loss. Some birth injuries, if injuries is by forceps or vacuum delivery, then it can lead to the trauma to the inner ear or hemorrhage to the inner ear and sensorineural loss. Then neonatal jaundice, when there is hyperbilirubinemia of more than 20 mg/cent, it can lead to sensorineural loss. Similarly, neonatal meningitis and sepsis. So these were some of the causes which are responsible for congenital sensorineural hearing loss. Then another part is acquired causes of sensorineural hearing loss. They can be divided into genetic causes and non-genetic causes. Now, genetic causes are further divided into non-syndromic and syndromic. Non-syndromic means though the hearing loss runs in families, that it is familial, but it is not syndromic. There is no other system in the body involved, only there is hearing loss. Another component of genetic is syndromic. Now there are many syndromes which are associated with hearing loss. So I have mentioned here some, for example, Waardenburg, Usher syndrome, Pendred syndrome, Alport syndrome. There are many other syndromes in which there is hearing loss and involvement of other parts of the body. Then there is non-genetic causes, acquired causes, non-genetic. They do not run in families. So what are those non-genetic causes of hearing loss? These are the infections of labyrinth, which can be viral infection or bacterial infection. then trauma to the labyrinth or the inner ear or the eighth nerve, which can be iatrogenic, that is during any ear surgery, or fractures of the temporal bone. Traumatic fractures of the temporal bone can lead to damage to the inner ear or the eighth nerve and sensory neural loss. Then another entity is noise induced hearing loss because of exposure to loud sounds. Then presbyacusis, it is hearing loss because of the physiological aging process. Then Meniere's disease, it is endolymphatic high drops where there is increased pressure in the endolymph and sensory neural hearing loss. Then acoustic neuroma. Now Meniere's disease, it is an example of cochlear type of SNHL, and acoustic neuroma, it is an example of neural type or retrocochlear type of SNHL. Then another entity is sudden sensory neural hearing loss. And then there are some systemic disorders like diabetes, hypothyroidism, multiple sclerosis, which can also cause sensory neural hearing loss. So all these are non-genetic causes of sensory neural hearing loss. The characteristic features of sensory neural hearing loss are, on tuning fork test, the Rinne test will be positive, that is air conduction will be more than bone conduction. The Weber will be lateralized to the better ear. For example, if a patient is having a sensory neural hearing loss in the right ear, then the Weber test, it will be the Weber test will be lateralized to opposite ear, that is left ear. The absolute bone conduction will be decreased as compared to the examiner. Then in sensory neural hearing loss, generally higher frequencies are affected more. On audiogram, we see there is no airborne gap, because airborne gap, it is suggestive of conductive component. In sensory neural hearing loss, there is no airborne gap. The speech discrimination is poor. It means that the patient sometimes they do hear sound, but they are not able to understand the speech. So the speech discrimination is poor in sensory neural hearing loss. The diagnosis of SNHL, it consists of a proper history. It should be antenatal history, it should be perinatal history, any drug history, any trauma. So a proper history is always required to pinpoint a diagnosis. Then severity of the hearing loss can be ascertained by a pure tone audiogram, where we can actually quantify the hearing loss. Then the type of audiogram is important. Type of audiogram means whether the higher frequencies are affected more, that is downslope curve, whether a particular frequency is affected, for example 4000 hertz, 4000 hertz notch as seen in noise induced hearing loss, or lower frequencies are affected, for example in early stages of Meniere's disease. So it is an upslope curve in Meniere's disease. So the type of audiogram gives us an idea of the which frequency is affected more. Then we should ascertain the site of the lesion. It can be done by radiological investigations, HRCT, temporal bone, MRI of the inner ear, if there is any pathology in the cochlea, any tumor, any nerve tumor, it can be known by radiographically, like X-ray and MRI, CT scan and MRI. Then some blood investigations to rule out systemic pathologies. For example, for diabetes, RBS is required. Then for syphilis, serological tests are required. To know the status of the thyroid hormone, we go for thyroid function tests. So these are some of the investigations which help us in diagnosing SNHL. Management of SNHL, it is the most important point is early detection. Especially this is important in children, because if the hearing loss in children is not detected at an early age, then it can hamper the speech development of the child. So early detection is very important. And if early detection we can either prevent the further progression, we can even treat some causes. For example, if the child is having hypothyroidism, then it can be treated if it is detected early. Or if not, if it is not treatable, then at least some rehabilitation can be given in the form of sound amplification, for example, hearing aid, or any surgical intervention like cochlear implant surgery. If we are able to find a cause of SNHL, we should treat that cause. And if there is no cause or nothing else can be done, then we can rehabilitate the patient by giving hearing aids and some type of speech therapy or signal therapy and so on. So that is rehabilitation. Now I will talk about some common causes of SNHL. These are mostly non-genetic causes. So one of them is syphilis. Now syphilis can involve the inner ear in various waves. It can cause the sudden sensorineural hearing loss, or it can cause Meniere's syndrome. Now, Meniere's syndrome, as we know, it is the secondary type of endolymphatic eye drops. Then, in syphilis, we see a positive Henneberg sign. Positive Henneberg sign means the fistula test is positive, though there is no fistula. The reason being that there are adhesions between the stapes, cord plate and perilymph. So on pressing the triggers, the patient sometimes complain of vertigo and nystagmus. So that is positive fistula test. False positive actually. There is no fistula. Then tuleo phenomena is also seen in syphilis, in which on exposure to the loud sound, patient complains of giddiness and vertigo. So syphilis can affect the inner ear in these four different types: sudden SNHL, Meniere's syndrome, Henneberg sign or tuleo phenomena. Then for diagnosis of syphilis, we go for fluorescent antibody absorption test, then VDRL, rapid plasma reagent test, and treatment consists of intravenous penicillin and steroids. Another important cause of sensorineural hearing loss is ototoxicity, that is toxicity because of some drugs. Now, this is a table which shows the drug groups, the which parts do they affect, what are the common symptoms and what is the mechanism of ototoxicity. So when we see aminoglycosides, they can be either vestibulotoxic or cochleotoxic. Vestibulotoxic aminoglycosides are streptomycin, tobramycin and gentamicin. They destroy the type 1 hair cells of the crista ampullaris and hence the patient will complain of giddiness. The cochleotoxic aminoglycosides are neomycin, kanamycin, amikacin and sisomycin. They destroy the outer hair cells and the patient will complain of hearing loss and tinnitus. Then another group is diuretics like furosemide, ethacrynic acid, bumetanide. They also involve the cochlear duct, and the hearing loss in with these drugs, it is bilateral, sudden, symmetrical. And the mechanism is they cause the edema and the cystic changes in the stria vascularis of the cochlear duct, that is scala media. Then another group is salicylates, which consist of methyl salicylate, aspirin. It affects cochlea, it leads to bilateral SNHL, tinnitus, and it interferes at the enzymatic level. Then some antimalarial drugs like quinine, chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, they also involve the cochlea. They can cause tinnitus and sensorineural hearing loss, and they cause the vasoconstriction of the small vessels in the stria vascularis. Then some cytotoxic drugs like nitrogen mustard, cisplatin, carboplatin, they also affect cochlea, they also cause SNHL and they affect the outer hair cells of the cochlea. Then ion chelating agent like deferoxamine, it involves the cochlea, causes high frequency sensorineural loss and it causes toxicity of the nerves. So these are some of the common drugs which are ototoxic. Then noise trauma. Now, noise trauma can be of two types. One is acoustic trauma, where there is a single brief exposure to a very intense sound. For example, explosion or a gunfire or a cracker. So there is only one exposure, but it is a sudden loud exposure. It can be of the order 140 to 170 decibels sound pressure level. And the mechanism of acoustic trauma with a single brief exposure is it can damage the outer ear cell, it can damage the organ of corti, or it can even damage the Reisner's membrane. So it will cause sensorineural loss. However, sometimes tympanic membrane can also be damaged, but that will cause a conductive type of hearing loss. Another type of noise trauma is noise-induced hearing loss, in which there is chronic exposure to less intense sounds. For example, people who are working in factories where there is continuous large sounds, or who are residing near railway stations, who are residing near airports, so they are chronically exposed to loud sounds but less intense. So it can be temporary or permanent. Now the Government of India, Ministry of Labour, they have proposed that 90 decibel intensity of sound for 8 hours a day for 5 days per week. It is the maximum safe limit recommended. And in noise induced hearing loss, if we get a pure tone audiogram done, then we see a typical dip in the frequency, dip in the hearing thresholds at 4000 hertz, which is called a 4K notch or 4000 hertz notch. So before employing the candidates in such jobs, there is always a pre-employment checkup to know the basic hearing thresholds, and then there are annual audiograms done to know if there is any effect of noise to the hearing thresholds or not. And for prevention of such noise induced hearing loss, the patients, the candidates, they are advised to use the earplugs when they are working in noisy environment, and whatever loss has already occurred, for that hearing aids can be prescribed. This is a pure tone audiogram. Now in this, it can be seen that there is a dip in the frequency, especially at 4000 hertz, so that is called a 4k notch. It is a typical feature of noise induced hearing loss. Now it should be differentiated from a 2000 hertz notch. 2000 hertz notch, it is a Karhart's notch, which is seen in otosclerosis. Here it is 4000 hertz notch, which is seen in noise induced hearing loss. Then another important cause of SNHL is the sudden sensory neural hearing loss. Wilson had proposed a definition of sudden SNHL as more than 30 decibel loss in three consecutive frequencies in less than 3 days. Now most of the time it is idiopathic, but various etiologies have been proposed. For example, infections like mumps, herpes, syphilis, it can be traumatic in origin. Then vascular, it can be because of thrombosis of the cochlear and the labyrinthine artery. Then some ear causes like Meniere's disease. So in Meniere's disease also sometimes there can be sudden SNHL and Cogan syndrome. Then some autotoxic drugs can also cause sudden SNHL. In acoustic neuroma, there can be sudden loss. Then some systemic pathologies like diabetes, multiple sclerosis, hypertension and hypothyroidism. So these are some of the proposed causes for sudden sensory neural hearing loss. The treatment of sudden sensory neural hearing loss is, first we should try to find out the cause by proper history taking, by proper examination and radiological investigations if required. Patient is asked to lie comfortable, reassure the patient, and steroids, again they form the mainstay of the treatment. And the prednisolone, it is given in the dose of 40 to 60 milligram single morning dose, and then it can be tapered over the next 3 weeks. Now sudden SNHL, it is sometimes called the medical emergency in ENT. So we should always admit the patient and start steroids as soon as possible. Then carbogen inhalation has also been shown to improve the cochlear blood flow and the hearing loss. Carbogen, it is a gaseous mixture of 5% carbon dioxide and 95% oxygen. Then low molecular weight dextran has also been shown to give good result. It decreases the blood viscosity and increases the blood flow. And similarly, hyperbaric oxygen therapy has also been shown to improve the sudden sensory neural hearing loss. So these are some of the modalities of the treatment, but again, steroids are the mainstay of the treatment and they should be initiated as early as possible when the diagnosis of sudden SNHL is done. Another cause of, rather very common cause of sensory neural hearing loss, it is presbyacusis, which is age-related SNHL, and it is a physiological aging process which generally manifests by the age of 65 years, though sometimes it can manifest earlier also. Now it can be divided into four types. It can be sensory. Sensory means there is age-related degeneration of the organ of Corti. Then it can be neural. That is age-related degeneration of the spiral ganglia. So one is sensory, other one is retrocochlear or neural. Then the pathology can be in the stria. That is, there can be atrophy of the stria vascularis, which leads to SNHL. Or cochlear conductive. It means there is stiffening of the basilar membrane. So there is no proper movement of the basilar membrane, no proper movement of the fluids, and the electrical impulses are not generated. So four pathologies have been identified for presbyacusis: sensory, neural, strial and cochlear conductive. Now the speech discrimination score is generally poor in such patients. That is, the patients are typically say that they are not able to understand the speech. Then recruitment is positive, especially if the presbyacusis, it is of sensory type, that is cochlear involvement. Then recruitment is positive. Recruitment means the patient is intolerant to loud sounds. And such patients are especially poor candidates for hearing aids. Otherwise, hearing aids are beneficial for presbyacusis patients. And general advice of stopping smoking, tea and coffee should be given, because all these nicotine and caffeine, they are known vasoconstrictors. So these things should be stopped. Thank you.